As Christ arrives in Jerusalem, he has less than a week before the Passover, that is, less than a week before his own passion. He still has many lessons to teach the disciples, as well as the rest of the Jewish people, and so he does not hold back. The Lord becomes very blunt and direct with his messages, and upsets many of the Jewish leaders with his preaching and actions. Since Jesus knows that his time has come, he is no longer being cautious, since he has no fear of death. Upon entering Jerusalem, Jesus goes to the temple. We remember that when Jesus was a child, he stayed in the temple after his parents and their company left, and they come back looking for him, and he said to them, "Why do you seek me? Do you not know that I must be about my Father's business?" Now the temple was an extremely large area, made up of courtyards and different sections, before getting into the main prayer areas and altars. This temple, known as the Second Temple, was much larger than the First Temple, which was built by King Solomon. As the Passover was approaching, Jewish pilgrims were coming from all over to celebrate the feast in the temple. Since people were traveling far distances, it would not have been practical for them to bring everything they needed, especially enough food and animals for their sacrifices. Since these feasts were almost like festivals, there were also a lot of souvenirs being sold, not unlike we would find in today's world. It was common for people to bring a lot of money with them to spend at the temple. Jesus drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. Jesus did not like what he saw there. He said, "It is written, 'My house is a house of prayer,'" quoting from Isaiah. Then he finished saying, "But you have made it a den of thieves," quoting from the prophet Jeremiah. This hurt the leaders of the temple, for they profited from the sales going on there. This made them want to kill Jesus all the more. People with all kinds of infirmities came to the temple and were being healed by Jesus. The children present cried out to him the same exclamations from his entry into Jerusalem, "Hosanna to the Son of David." The Jewish leaders were indignant and said to Jesus, "Do you hear what these are saying?" And Jesus said to them, "Yes, have you never read, 'Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise,'" a direct quote from Psalm 117. To keep everything in context, Jesus had just arrived in Jerusalem, and it was only 5 days before his passion. He was teaching daily in the temple. The chief priests, scribes, and elders sought to destroy Jesus, but they were cautious as the people were anxiously listening to his teachings, and they knew that killing Jesus would create a riot. A riot would have meant that the Roman soldiers would come and most likely kill everyone involved, so they needed to wait before seizing Jesus. The chief priests, scribes, and elders continued to try to test Jesus, hoping that they could make him say something that would turn the people against him. They asked him, "Tell us, by what authority are you doing these things? Or who is he who gave you this authority?" Jesus responded with another question, "I also will ask you one thing, and answer me. The baptism of John, was it from heaven or from men?" They knew immediately that Jesus had trapped them. They spoke amongst themselves, saying, "If we say, 'From heaven,' he will say, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say, 'From men,' all the people will stone us, for they are persuaded that John was a prophet." So they answered that they did not know where it was from, and Jesus said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things." Jesus' intention was not simply to trap them, but he actually gave them their answer. John's baptism was from heaven, the same place where Christ had his authority to perform miracles and teach the mysteries of God. On their way back from Jerusalem, Jesus was hungry and went to a fig tree to find fruit, but the tree was barren. He said to the tree, "Let no fruit grow on you ever again." Immediately the fig tree withered away. We know that Jesus would get hungry and need to eat, since he was fully man. But Jesus, who knows everything, knew that the fig tree would not have any fruit on it yet he approached it anyway, most likely to teach the disciples an important lesson. There are two main points here. First, the disciples were amazed at how the fig tree immediately withered at Christ's word. He explains to them that if they truly have faith, they too will be able to do this, and much more. Christ is teaching them the power of praying with faith. The second and possibly more important point is that here the fig tree represents the Jewish synagogue. This particular fig tree had leaves, but not fruit. The leaves of a fig tree look like human hands. This tree represents the people in the synagogue, who appear to be holy, represented by the green leaves, but bore no fruit, that is, produced nothing good, and did not have any spiritual attributes past their appearance. By not bearing any fruit, the fig tree is disobedient to God, who created it in order to bear fruit. It is not fulfilling its purpose. Likewise, the Jews, who were the chosen people of God, used God as a pretext, but are not fulfilling their purpose. At Christ's death on the cross, the curtain of the temple is torn in two. The old Jewish faith is withered as quickly as the fig tree at Christ's curse. The road that the tree was found on represents the world. We are not able to bear the fruits of righteousness if we become of the world. The Jews had become part of the world, and not separate to God, as he had intended, and so they were unable to bear fruit. Likewise, if we as Christians live as part of the world rather than set aside from the world, neither will we be able to bear fruit. Some may wonder at why Christ cursed the fig tree and did not just walk away. We must remember that Christ did not cause it not to bear fruit. It did not bear fruit on its own, so Christ cursed it and caused it to wither so that it would no longer bear leaves, so that others would not be fooled by it. In other words, Christ exposed this fig tree as the failure that it was. No one can hide his true self from God. Since God is the source of life, to curse this fig tree is to pull his life-giving self from it. Likewise, it wasn't because God abandoned them that the Jews squandered his righteousness. Rather, because they failed to produce the fruits of righteousness, God abandoned them to ensure that they would not have the appearance or reputation of righteousness. Christ is about to give another parable to illustrate the same point once again. Just like the encounter with the fig tree and other rebukes against the Pharisees and Jewish leaders, Christ now gives the parable of the wicked vine dressers as a rebuke to them who have rejected God over and over. The parable begins, "There was a certain landowner who planted a vineyard and set a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. And he leased it to vine dressers and went into a far country." The landowner in this parable is God. The vineyard is the nation of Israel, and God put everything in there that they would ever need. Kings and priests were the stewards of God's vineyards, and their duty was to lead the people to spiritual fruitfulness and fidelity to their covenant with God. The landowner going to a far country meant God's patience with his people, even though they were very sinful. He was giving them more chances to bear fruit. "Now, when vintage time drew near," the parable continues, "he sent his servants to the vine dressers that they might receive its fruit. And the vine dressers took his servants, beat one, killed one, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did likewise to them. The landowner's servants, whom he sent to receive the fruit, were the prophets of the Old Testament. In the third book of Kings, we see many accounts of the Jews rejecting the prophets of God through persecution and murder. By sending the prophets, God was giving the Jews several chances to repent and bear good fruit. He was calling them back from their sinfulness and idolatry. Last of all, the landowner sends his son, but they kill him. This, of course, is Christ telling of what the Jews were about to do to him. Jesus then asks the people what the landowner would do to those tenants after they killed his son. The people responded, "He will destroy those wicked men miserably and lease his vineyard to other vine dressers who will render to him the fruits in their season." This was the fate of the Jews who rejected the prophets and the Son of God. Likewise, The new tenants are the Gentiles who accept Jesus Christ as God. Christ then quotes Psalm 118 concerning himself, saying, "The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes." Jesus Christ is the stone, because his foundation is solid, and because he will destroy the wicked. Only a foundation built on the Lord will remain standing. Another similar parable is given by the Lord. The accounts of this parable are slightly different in the Gospel according to Saints Matthew and Luke. A king, who represents God in this parable, puts on a wedding banquet for his son and sends his servants to call all those who were invited to the wedding feast. Those guests were not willing to come, so the king sent his servants to call the people again, but they made excuses and did not come. Some even seized his servants and killed them. Like in the last parable, these are the Jewish people killing the prophets and rejecting God's message and invitation for salvation. When the king hears what they had done, he becomes furious and sends out his armies to kill those wicked people and burn up their city. The ones who did come to attend were not worthy. This portion of the parable becomes the theme for the bridegroom Orthros of Holy Week, and especially the hymn, "I see thy bridal chamber richly adorned, but I have no wedding garment to worthily enter." The king finally sends his servants to the highway to bring in people, both good and bad, until the wedding hall was filled with guests. This parable summarizes the history of salvation: God sending his messengers, Moses and the prophets, into the world to proclaim his will and the coming salvation, the coming of Christ, the Jews' rejection of the Savior, the call of the Gentiles, and the mission of the church to proclaim the gospel and baptize the whole world. The end of this parable really expresses God's desire to have heaven full of his beloved people. God desires not the death of the sinner, but that they repent and live. Once again, the rulers of the temple sought a way to destroy Jesus. This time, instead of trying to turn the people against Jesus, they thought they had a sure plan to turn the Romans against him. The Romans, after all, had no problem killing Jews, as it was a normal occurrence. They knew that Jesus was aware of their hatred towards him, and so they sent spies who pretended to be righteous in order to make him fall. They asked him, saying, "Teacher, we know that you say and teach rightly, and you do not show personal favoritism, but teach the way of God in truth. Is it lawful for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" Jesus, knowing their hearts, responded, asking, "Why do you test me? Show me a denarius. Whose image and inscription does it have?" They answered and said, "Caesar's." And he said to them, "Render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." The inscription on the coin translated means, "Tiberius Caesar, son of the divine Augustus." After Caesar Augustus died, he was given the title Son of God. This inscription was over Tiberius Caesar's image. They asked him this question because if he responded that they should not pay taxes to Caesar, the Romans would have killed him. But if he responded to pay taxes to Caesar, he would not be the Messiah that the Jewish people had expected, one who would free the Jews from the Romans, and so the people would have turned against him. It was a win-win for the Jewish leaders. The meaning of Christ's answer may seem obvious, that Christ is telling them to give Caesar, meaning the Roman authorities, their coins, and to give the things of God, such as their hearts, to God. Jesus' answer is actually much deeper and full of wisdom. He asked, "Whose image," literally icon in the original Greek, "was on the coin?" And they responded, "Caesar's." Caesar, being a man, was made in the image or icon of God. The image on the coin was the image of God. Jesus was actually saying that all things are from God and belong to God. Without being obvious and falling into their trap, Christ is saying that nothing belongs to Caesar. While Jesus was still in the temple, he was watching people give their offerings to God, and he saw many rich people put a lot of money in the box. Then he saw a poor widow put 2 mites into the treasury. A mite was worth close to nothing, but to someone barely scraping by, 2 mites may have meant a very modest amount of food that they desperately needed. we remember that a woman with no husband and no son was not able to own anything and was extremely poor. A widow could only do two things to survive, become a beggar or a prostitute. It would seem that this woman was a beggar. The rich, in their abundance, were giving larger amounts of money, but hardly felt the loss of their gift to God. The widow, on the other hand, had so little that her two mites meant more to God than the larger amounts of the rich people. God can bless her minuscule amount and have it do more good than the thousands of dollars that the rich give. The way she gave is the way God requires us to give. Christ had required the disciples to give the 5 loaves and 2 fish, everything they had, in order to feed the people. When they did so, God blessed it and created a miracle, feeding over 5,000 people. We should always give out of love, perfect love, and God will bless us abundantly. We can compare the widow in this story to the widow of Zarephath, who hosted the prophet Elias in her home. The widow in the Old Testament had only a little flour and oil when Elias requested bread from her. In her poverty, she gave all that she had. As a result, God gave the prophet Elias the ability to raise the widow's son from death after he had fallen into a sudden illness. God accepted her small amount of flour and oil as an acceptable offering and gave her her entire world back.